We're at Baylys Beach, here on the west coast of Northland, just out from Dargaville. And to show you on a map exactly where we are, at the north tip of the Kuiper Sand Barrier. Now, the Kuiper and the Manukau Sand Barriers are the largest sand dune barriers in New Zealand. So let's have a look. If this was the Kuiper Bay 2 million years ago, this is the land here, and this is the sea. In the last 2 million years, sand coming up the coast has built up a large sand dune barrier from the south, Kuiper South Head, and another one has built up on the north side, North Kuiper Sand Dune Barrier. Dargaville is up here, and we're here at Baylys Beach. All right? So the question is, how did these sand barriers build up? We know the sand came from big eruptions in the centre of the North Island and was brought northwards by longshore drift. So we've got a source for all this quartz sand. And it's been coming up here for the last 1.5 million odd years. Now, during this time, we've been in the Ice Age climate cycles of cold, warm, cold, warm. So if we look at a graph of the climate back through time, if we are here at the warm period, we go back down to a cold period in the last ice age peak, back up, down, cold, warm, cold, warm, going all the way back to 2.5 million years ago. So this is us here in the warm period, cold, warm, cold. But not only has the climate been changing, but sea level has been changing as well at the same time. So at present, the sea level is high and has been during each of the warm periods back through time. But during these cold periods, when there was a lot more ice on the land, especially in the Northern Hemisphere as an ice cap, a lot of the water in the sea was taken out and was sitting on land in that ice cap. So sea level fell. Back here at the peak of the last ice age, just 20,000 years ago, sea level was 130 meters lower than present. It was about 100 meters lower during each one of these periods, and sea level has only been up high here for about 10% of the time in the last 1 million years. So how did we get the sand building up above sea level up at this height during these periods of time? And that's the question we want to look at today. So let's have a look at what's eroding in the cliffs here, some of these ancient sand dunes, and see what they look like. So here we have, up to that point, one system of dune. The sand is blowing along, and then down the slope of the dune it cascades, and so it builds up these layer upon layer that are at an angle to the horizontal. And that's typical of a sand dune advancing with the wind blowing in this direction. Above, we've got more sand dune, only this one's been blowing at a slightly different angle, like so, and it's been advancing in that direction. So here we've got two series of sand dunes at different times building up. And a lot of the sand dune barrier has these typical dune cross-bedded sands. Okay, so we've seen some sand dunes. So when did the sand get thrown up on the back of the beach, dry out, and then get blown inland to build the sand dunes? It must have been when sea level was rather high, close to what it is now. But at the present time, it's eroding here. That's because sea level is slowly rising, and sand is being taken away from the dunes and out into the coastal system. But for sand to be blown up onto the beach and be left there, then we come to the point where sea level is beginning to fall after a warm period. And so it's in this period here when the sand would be thrown up on the beach, when the sea level is falling up on the beach, dry out, and be blown inland and form the dunes. So the dunes are presumably being built during this period, this period, this period, back through time. So we've got a long time in between when it's cold and when it's up at the peak of the warm cycle, when there wouldn't be any moving sand. So what happened at that time when there's no active sand dunes? Let's go and have another look and see if we can find those periods and how they're recorded. And if we go up through this dune, we get up to a base of a layer of black, quite thick, lignite. This lignite, in fact, is compacted and slightly hardened peat. So in the sea cliffs we've got here, in fact, can recognize five levels of lignite formation, or soil formation, ancient soil formation. just along the beach here, a big block of this has fallen down. So we can have a look at some of this close up in one of the fallen blocks. And we can see it's got a lot of wood in it. It's black, got a lot of organic matter that's been broken down, leaves, twigs, etc. And it accumulated in a peat swamp. So this material is telling us that the whole area around it was forested at that time. This peat swamp probably would have accumulated in a depression between the dunes. So it's an interdune peat swamp, and the dunes themselves were forested. And we get even more evidence of that just here, where we've got a tree stump in situ. And here's the stump. And it's a very large tree that was growing on the edge of that peat swamp at that time. Now, if we look closely at it, here's some kauri gum in the splits in the wood. So that's telling us that this tree was probably a large kauri. So there was kauri forest, but probably a number of other warm, temperate, broad-leafed trees growing on the sand dunes at that time. And the base of some of the peats actually have pollen of colder forests, beech forest, whereas they move up into pollen of tree types and forests that lived in those warmer parts of the climate cycle. Just to remind you where we are in the climate cycles, if that's the present day temperature, this is today and we're in the warm, they come down going back in time to the peak of the last ice age 20,000 years ago, up to the last warm period, cold, warm, cold, warm. And we know that the sand was being added to the barrier as sea level fell from the warm period as sea level fell here and here. So we have these periods of time in here when we probably had the peat swamps accumulating. So it's in the colder periods down to the peak of the cold and right even up to the peak of the warm, but not during the time when the sand was thrown up on the beach and the dunes were blown into the forest and killed and buried them. So here we see, in fact, the fifth of these young peats that has become a lignite, this black layer in the cliff here. So that's five warm periods back in time. Takes us back to about 300 to 400,000 years ago. So this is the only one of those lignite beds that has a white layer like this in it. When we look close, it's very fine-grained volcanic ash, a layer of fine volcanic ash of rhyolitic composition, which clearly means it erupted from the centre of the North Island about 400 to 500 kilometres away. So around 350,000 years ago, a big eruption in the centre of the North Island put ash into the air, which blew in this direction, and it's landed on the North Kaipara dune barrier. And where we have these peat swamps, it's accumulated in the peat swamp and been preserved between layers of organic matter, which is now this black lignite. Where it landed on sand dunes, if they were active, the ash would have been mixed in with the blowing sand and not been preserved, and it disappeared. One of the most useful things of having an ash layer like this is that they can study the chemistry of that ash and be able to fingerprint it back to a known eruption, where they also know the age of that eruption. And so we can get an age of when this lignite was accumulating in the peat swamp based on the age of that eruption. So we're now a couple of hundred metres south of Chase's Gully, and we're in the lowest of the lignite bands in the sequence, the sixth youngest in fact. And here in the beach it's almost flat lying, which we would expect, but as we look at it going up into the cliff, it goes up at quite an angle, nearly 20 degrees. And that's a little bit odd. You would think that may be indicating that there's been uplift and tilting, but no, I don't think so. I think it's all a result of compaction. So if we have a look at a picture here, so the lignite accumulated an interdune depression like so. And originally the water level is obviously going to be horizontal like so, and the organic matter will accumulate layer upon layer on the floor of that swamp. It will have filled right up to here, so we've got lignite on both sides like so. Now when later on the moving wind-blown sand built up sand dunes across it like so, and more, and maybe up to 50 meters of sand on top. This was 10 meters thick. With that weight of sand, it compacted it down. So it compacted down to only 2 or 3 meters in the middle and didn't compact it much on either side. And look what we're left with. We've got it flat at the bottom here and it curves right up to 20 degrees and it's pinching out. up over there as well. So that probably explains why it's on a 20 degree angle. Here in the dipping part of that lignite lens, we find a layer that's rich in leaves. And if we pick away in amongst it, we may be able to get a leaf or something out. Here's one here. That's a very nice leaf that's come out. Oh, what's this down here? Look at that. Those are perfect kauri leaves. Here, for example, we see what appear to be perhaps scales off a cone of a kauri tree. In summary, what have we found here at Baylys Beach? We've been able to recognise six of these lignite layers, black lignite layers, that represent cold through to the warmest peaks of the Ice Age climate cycles, when there was the dunes areas were forested and there were interdune swamps. And in between them, we've got periods when moving sand from the back of the beach blew across as sand dunes, and so we built up this section that's about 80 metres thick here at Baylys Beach. And counting back through these climate cycles, that takes us back to the last 400,000 years. But the geologists mapping this particular barrier have recognised older sequences further inland, and they have a rhyolitic ashes in them that have been dated at 1 million years old. So we know that further inland part of this barrier was accumulating even further back during the climate cycles.